there have been numerous papers saying that there are indications that scientific progress is actually slowing down. And you can always ask, like, exactly how did they measure scientific progress? And everyone does it in their own way. Like, this is an entire art discipline, basically, where they make up new measures. And so the reason why I find it convincing is that it doesn't really matter exactly how they did it. They always found more or less the same thing, which is that scientific progress has been slowing down since the 1960s, 1970s, which is also consistent with this economic analysis. And then there is like the narrative side of this story, which is what John Horgan wrote about in his book, The End of Science, which is exactly what we started from. Like this impression, we're not really making progress on these big open questions. Like they've been open for a long time and nothing seems to be happening. So John Horgan thinks that we've just reached the end of science, which is why his book is titled that way. And I think that that's a little bit too extreme, but I think his observation is basically correct. And he's actually written a new preface for the book at the 20-year anniversary, which was just a couple of years ago, in which he says, well, you know, I've re-investigated the points that I made in the book, and they basically turned out to be correct. You know, we haven't figured out what consciousness is. We still don't know what dark matter is. We still don't know what quantum gravity is. We're still talking vague words about what complexity is and stuff like this. And I think it's basically correct. And so we cannot talk about the objections to this because they're always more or less the same. I find it a little bit tiring. You must get the same thing on social media, that they're always the same objections that come from people who have never heard of the topic before, and you just end up endlessly repeating the same things over and over again. So in this case, like the typical objection is that as science gets more mature, it becomes more difficult to make progress, so progress slows down. And what you can hold against this, where on the other hand, the number of scientists is exponentially increasing, which already makes us a little bit suspect. And then the other issue is that different disciplines, you know, if you look at something like medicine and physics, for example, like physics is much older than what people started. I mean, you know, we can talk about exactly when did medicine actually start, but because there was a lot of hocus pocus in the early days. But serious medicine is much younger a discipline than physics, which is basically, you know, thousands of years old, especially astronomy. So what sense does it make that progress in all of these disciplines would slow down at the same time?
Right.
If it's just something to do with the nature of knowledge itself, it's not what it looks like. It looks like it's a systemic problem with the way that we organize research. And I understand that this is not a watertight argument, but I think it's quite plausible. And at the very least, you'd think it's something to take seriously, that we have to change something about the way that we organize science.
Okay, so then it's not an argument that the foundations haven't changed. It's more about questions have remained open and not answered in quite some time. And it's been that way for a variety of fields around the same time.
Yeah, so that's entirely right. So my biggest problem is not that these questions have remained open for such a long time, but that we're not getting anywhere. Like, so we're just doing the same thing over again, and it seems to be a systemic problem in all fields. So it just feels to me like something isn't quite right. Does it make sense?
Yeah, the only field I don't see this in, I don't see someone saying that there's a crisis in physics, crisis in ecology, meaning crisis, everyone's in a crisis, except computer science.
Yeah, right.
And the foundations of computer science hasn't changed since the 40s, since even before physics, since Turing and Church. Now, there are unanswered questions about the limits of computability and complexity issues, but those are like machine code questions that are close to the base, but they don't question the base.
Yeah, so actually, I think one could make a fair point that pretty much all the progress that we see in science overall has actually been driven by maybe not exactly computer science, but computer science in the general sense, extended to technology, technological applications, data analysis, and so on and so forth. I mean, certainly, like in physics itself, I remember when I was a student, if you had an integral that you could not solve, that was not in a table,
you just couldn't solve it.
That was the end of your research. You were like, okay, that's it. Can't solve this integral.
It's funny.
Like, and this is just, this problem has just totally evaporated, right? You're like, okay, we can't solve this integral. We put it into computer, problem solved. And this is like such a trivial thing almost, how computing power has made such a big impact in physics. And it's certainly also in other disciplines. Like if you look at medicine, just data analysis, if you look at MRI, fMRI, all this stuff, it's you need to analyze this data. You need computers, right? So I think this is what it's driven by. But then you can also ask, well, what made this progress in computer science possible? And I would say, well, ultimately, it's all physics, right? You need to know, well, what are semiconductors, how do they work, what's a band gap, and all this kind of stuff. And, I know there are people who are arguing, like, this is not, like, historically, it's not how it happened. It was more an accidental thing. Some people were tinkering around with stuff here and there. It's not like they sat there and developed a theory for semiconductors and then they built it. This is not what happened. But I still think, like, if you look at it from a constructive point of view, in the sense of how does science build up, it goes back to our understanding of physics, of materials, of electricity, and so on. So this is where it comes from.
Yes.
And so what we're doing right now is that we're trying to get out of the science that we have already discovered what we possibly can. So we're making computers smaller and smaller, and there's a lot left to do. Actually, John Horgan makes it very clear in his book that this is not what he's talking about. So there's a lot of stuff that you can build up on the science that we know already, for example, in computing, and there's also, robotics and so on, which kind of seems to be the next thing, the next big thing that will come knocking at the door, seems to be robots.
Yes.
And so there's a lot of research left to do. But what he's concerned with, and what I'm also concerned with, are these big new discoveries about the world. And so, of course, I'm as a physicist, I'm very opinionated about these things. But I think that physics, and especially the foundations of physics, are a super important discipline, because it's where we get the deepest insights about nature. So if we don't make progress in the foundations of physics, then sooner or later, progress in all other disciplines is also going to run dry. And so I know this sounds a little bit bombastic, and there are a lot of people who would disagree with this. And you probably know this entire argument about what do we actually mean by fundamental. Is biology any less fundamental than physics? I would say yes, but biologists might disagree. In any case, so I think that if we really want to make progress as a society as a whole, we need to make progress in the foundations of physics, in the sense of actually discovering some new phenomenon. Yeah, maybe understanding quantum mechanics. Uh-huh. Maybe it's quantum gravity, though I personally think this is somewhat unlikely. But anything, something really.
Yes. So you don't see your work on superdeterminism as just contributing to the useless papers that are produced?
No, of course not. And even if that was the case, I'd never admit it. We already talked about this. Like, I overthink everything. If I make a joke, I read like 3 books and I analyze joke structures, as you say, and I think about the subtext, and I try to find the most punchy phrase, and which word comes in which order. How do I start?
Oh, that's
stuff
interesting.
Like this.
Great.
Right. And so this is also more or less how I've approached the question of what do I make my research on? This is why I wrote my first book. It was trying to figure out what should I spend my time on, because there's only so much time in my life. So what's the most promising thing to work on? And I've tried to take my own advice very seriously, maybe not totally successful, but at least I've tried. And so I've tried to not work on the problems that I think are pseudo problems, but I've tried to focus on the problems that I said are real problems, where time is well spent. Now, the issue is that I couldn't get funding to work on those. And this is why I'm now in the position that I am, where I'm funding my own research by making videos on YouTube. And I rely a lot on people supporting me, like people on Patreon, people who join my channel, who I'm super, super grateful for, because otherwise it wouldn't be possible. And so the reason I ended up working on the super determinism stuff is that I arrived at the conclusion like that the best way to make progress is to figure out what happens in a measurement in quantum mechanics. And why this particular problem? Because we know it's something that is in the measurable range. Like, it's literally a measurement process. Like, it happens in the laboratory all the time, and it quite plausibly has a relevance for practical applications, exactly because it's in a parameter range that is easily experimentally accessible, that we actually already access with devices that we build.
As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts, from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.